Well, when you go into a field, because of my competitive spirit, in part that I learned from athletics, you should go in with the passion to try to do your best. And that's why the people that I brought to Mexico, I always told them on the first day, we're going to teach you to be rebels, not with guns and daggers, but with science and technology.
Well, as a farmer and someone who was involved in the political world, I was excited and thrilled when he won the Nobel Peace Prize back in the very early 70s. And ever since then, Norman Borlaug has been a hero of mine.
So we've been taught in China about green revolution. And we know very well that in our textbook, the father of the Green Revolution, Norman Borlaug.
It really is true that he has fed hundreds of millions of people, in effect, with his science, his commitment, his willingness to devote day in, day out of his extraordinarily rich and long life to the pursuit of human betterment.
And I am not one to sit idly by and see man breed himself into a corner by increasing his numbers faster than food production is being increased. And if I have anything to contribute to this world, when I know that our scientific facts are right and we have materials that can be brought together in a meaningful production program, I'm going to play that card and play it hard.
Today, as during many other times in history, there are grave concerns about food shortages and the unrest caused by famine. The same was true when the birth rate increased after the Second World War, causing predictions that population growth would outstrip food supplies and cause great human suffering. During that period, when the hungry of the world needed a champion, a most unlikely hero emerged. He was not a politician nor power broker, but an American farm boy whose discoveries would save more than a billion people from starvation.
I grew up on the land, on a small farm in northeast Iowa. This farm was composed of only 50 acres, only half of which was cultivated land. But life was not always easy.
Winters were severe. At that time, lots of snow, cold. We used to walk to school, except when there were severe blizzards. And then someone would come for us in a sled.
The one-room school was a mile and a half walk each way. There was only one teacher for all eight grades, and many older children only attended in winter when they would not be needed for farm chores.
This was in glaciated part of the country, and so there were a lot of rocks. Every spring, we'd carry these rocks off the field, skid them off on a skidder, and next spring, there'd be more of them. I'd say, where did these grow from? Why did we have a new crop of rocks every spring?
Young Norman had a close relationship with Grandfather Nels, who saw great potential in his grandson's curious mind. He told Norman, just don't stop asking why things are the way they are.
Oh, but I'm a product of the worst of the Depression. Second year in high school, all the banks went broke. And so you saw many of the best farmers lose everything.
He came from the farm where they had lots of food. And then when he got into the Twin Cities, it was during the Depression and people were hungry, and that made a lasting impression on him.
And then my granddad, he used to say, Norman, you see what's happening. You got to get a good education. The banks can go broke, depressions can come and go, but if you got a good education, you can take off down a different road. It's the best protection you have. I became a wrestler in high school. Our principal was also the wrestling coach, Dave Bartelma.
Under his tutelage, Norman Borlaug not only became a champion wrestler, but also a star football and baseball player. The Iowa State Teachers College wrestling coach recruited him right off the mat. But like so many of the twists and turns that were to change Borlaug's life unexpectedly, one day a Model A Ford pulled into the Borlaug's driveway, driven by another Cresco athlete who was on the University of Minnesota's football team.
The person who had taken me to Minnesota was George Champlin, but he came down one day before early football practice at Minnesota. He said, you better ride along with me. My dad says that you've got good potential. So I went to Minnesota.
Borlaug found a job at the university coffee shop where he worked for his meals. Another student, sophomore Margaret Gibson, earned her board there too. Borlaug decided to major in forestry at the College of Agriculture. As he moved ahead in his studies, he and Margaret had an understanding that they would marry when he could support her.
On the assurance that I had a job starting mid-January of 38 back with the Forest Service in central Idaho, Margaret and I got married. And then I got a letter that said, you delay your arrival until the 1st of June. We got some budgetary problems.
Borlaug had caught the eye of a prominent professor, E.C. Stakeman, head of the Department of Plant Pathology, not in the classroom but at a wrestling match. Stakeman invited Borlaug to attend one of his lectures on plant diseases, which Borlaug found fascinating.
I went to see Stakeman and I said, look, I'd like to take some graduate work in forest diseases, forest pathology.
That looks like rust. It just looks like iron rust, you see. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Stakeman encouraged Borlaug to get a graduate degree in plant pathology and offered him a position in his lab, which included a stipend for tuition and living expenses. Borlaug grabbed this straw as a way to stay afloat during the hard times, without realizing this opportunity would catapult him into his lifelong mission. Stakeman's specialty was rust, the parasitic fungal disease that affects trees, plants, and especially wheat. He taught Borlaug that new races of rust were formed through hybridization, and these attacked previously rust-resistant crops.
Borlaug's professor, Stakeman, was the first to study these airborne things. He would put flypaper on the front of an airplane wing and fly over the Great Plains collecting these spores.
I was offered an opportunity to go to DuPont Chemical Company. A few weeks after I'd signed this contract or been given this job, Pearl Harbor came. And so the laboratory that I was to have worked with on agricultural chemicals was converted into laboratory for the armed forces.
Borlaug's microbiology lab developed camouflage paint, protective aerosols, and water-purifying chemicals. He also studied the effects of fungal organisms on the deterioration of material in tropical war zones. His family life was blissfully normal, and 2 years later, their daughter, Norma Jean, was born. Margaret and Norman did not know then that they never would spend as much time together again. In November 1939, Franklin Delano Roosevelt won his third election for the presidency. His vice presidential choice was Henry A. Wallace, another son of Iowa, who had been his Secretary of Agriculture. President Roosevelt asked Wallace to attend the inauguration of the new president of Mexico.
They particularly wanted to take Wallace to central Mexico, the oldest part, land that had been cultivated before the Spanish arrived. And he went, he saw, and he was horrified by the kind of agriculture.
Wallace was concerned to find famine conditions so close to home. The vice president-elect returned to Washington, determined to improve the pitiful conditions he had witnessed.
And so he called the Rockefeller Foundation, and he said, "I think this is a challenge that you should accept."
Before making any decisions, the Rockefeller Foundation wanted to survey the situation. They put together a dream team of scientists to study Mexico's agriculture problems in depth.
To make a long story short, this program was started, the joint undertaking by the Rockefeller Foundation and Mexican government in 1943.
Stakeman proposed Borlaug for the project. But Margaret was pregnant again, and although Borlaug was intrigued by the chance to tackle starvation issues, he wondered whether he should give up his crisp lab coat for an unknown venture that would also lead to family upheaval and long separations. Some of the Mexican fields had been continuously cultivated for 2,000 years without replenishing soil nutrients. Following a revolution early in the 20th century, millions of acres were redistributed from the powerful to peasants, many of whom lacked the skills and tools to farm. Mexicans depended on expensive imported corn and wheat to survive. The Rockefeller team wanted to bring about a bloodless revolution, one that could conquer hunger and malnutrition with crops fashioned to suit local climate and soils.
I joined that program in 44 and have been involved in international agriculture ever since.
Borlaug spent his first weeks in Mexico working in experimental plots at an agricultural school. He and the program's director, George Herrar, another of Stakeman's proteges, concentrated on wheat while Edwin Wellhausen specialized in corn. But once they went out into the countryside, their undertaking seemed insurmountable.
I thought I'd made the dreadful mistake when I resigned from DuPont, when I saw the situation. It was still the tail end of World War II. You couldn't buy any equipment. We had no microscopes. We had no tractors. And there were no trained people.
There wasn't much of any facility up there in those early days either. It was a kind of an old ramshackle building that you had to use as headquarters and sleeping quarters and everything, because the town didn't amount to anything in the early days either.
He swept out the rats, slept on the floor overnight, nights, and there was a lady next door who had a car who drove him into town once a week to buy canned food for the week.
Borlaug and Wellhausen became ill from the poor water and food. Racked by dysentery, Borlaug wondered if he had been crazy to give up his comfortable life in Delaware. But what sustained him was his desire to alleviate the greater human misery he saw around every bend in the road.
Nobody knows or appreciates Dr. Borlaug at this time, but he started work here on really bad conditions in this experimental camp. There were no house where to live. He was sleeping in the warehouse.
Almost any other professor would have either demanded modern equipment and trained assistants or returned home. In a moment of frustration, Borlaug strapped a rope harness over his own shoulders and pulled a cultivator to prepare soil for planting. He overcame the hardships of his assignment with the determination to find a way to combat hunger by using whatever it would take, be it his brute strength or his brain power. Wheat supplies much of the world's critical dietary protein and carbohydrate nourishment. Second only to maize as the most produced food in the world, wheat, lauded as the staff of life, was first domesticated from wild grasses in the Fertile Crescent about 10,000 years ago.
Wheat, you could say from some standpoints, is the most important crop, and it feeds very large numbers of people.
Borlaug decided that if he could increase the yield of wheat, farmers would become enthused and try to use the same techniques. The first urgent problem he tackled was the fungus disease called rust, which Professor Stakeman had warned was a shifty, changing, constantly evolving enemy.
Rust is its most formidable disease. It can jump from wheat to an alternate host, the barberry plant. And it can go through many kinds of sexual permutations and come up with new races that can attack a previously resistant wheat plant.
During Borlaug's first year in Mexico, there was an epidemic of stem rust. He had to search quickly for rust-resistant varieties to save future crops.
It gets started on a large area, and it can put up incredible numbers of spores. It can just almost turn the sky red. And if they descend on your crop is finished.
Borlaug was looking for varieties of wheat that could withstand various diseases, climate zones, and soil conditions. He began collecting samples of wheat from Mexico, imported others from around the world, and launched the tedious work of crossbreeding.
At that time, very few crosses were being made in all of the conventional program. And we made hundreds and soon thousands each year. And that meant that you had a tremendous genetic soup of many combinations. And we selected and discarded ruthlessly.
He planted, waited, and watched for the results. The work was delicate, backbreaking, and exhausting. Nobody on the team worked harder than Borlaug himself.
Usually, you can find here, Dr. Borlaug here, at 5, 6 o'clock in the morning, and he left until there's no light.
At that time, most breeders would look at specific parents and make a very small number of what they thought would be well-chosen crosses. Borlaug felt you just couldn't predict how they were going to combine. Just cross the hell out of them, as he would say. You know, every combination you could think of, as many as you could think of, and then throw a lot of them away. See which ones really came together or combined well.
The first crosses were made in 1945, and 2 years later, they had reached 1,500. Borlaug was looking for wheat with resistance to rust and especially high yield. Many of Borlaug's young associates caught his enthusiasm for crossbreeding wheat. And sooner than anyone predicted, they had new varieties that were completely resistant to rust, a resistance that survived for more than 40 years. Breeding wheat is a time-consuming process. In order to scale up to do thousands of crosses, Borlaug trained local workers. Removing the pollen-producing anthers from one plant and transferring to it the pollen from another plant enables controlled crossbreeding of wheat. Here we see a head of wheat being emasculated several days before it is ready to flower. Carefully, the male anthers are removed, 3 from each flower. The worker protects the spike with a bag until the female organs, which remain, have time to mature. A few days later, a flowering spike is brought from another variety chosen to be the pollen-producing parent of the cross. The flowers are cut open, but it takes several minutes for the pollen to begin to emerge. The top of the protective bag is cut open, and pollen from the selected plant is emptied into the bag and mixed with the original emasculated spike.
Ahí está, ahí se ve. Ahí está el pollen.
To protect the pollinated plant, the technician recloses the bag, which prevents any wind-blown pollen from contaminating the cross.
Para que no se vaya.
This guarantees accuracy, and the tag records the data. If the experiment succeeds, the result will be a hybrid wheat with desirable characteristics from both parent plants.
You use the best seed from your breeding program that's available at any point in time. And this is an ongoing process.
Borlaug was impatient. After 5,000 crosses of bred wheat, only two were rust resistant. With just one crop each year, he estimated it would take more than 10 years to achieve his goal. He proposed setting up a second agricultural station in the Yaqui Valley, 800 miles north, with seasonal differences that could give them two growing seasons a year and double the rate of crossbreeding. But there were obstacles to setting up shop in two locations. There weren't even any connecting roads.
Norm saw the potential of the large acreage of irrigated land in the state of Sonora on the Mexican West Coast. But to get there, he had to overcome management's reluctance at first. Then he had to drive in a pickup truck all the way into the United States, over to Tucson, Arizona, and down to the old experiment station, which had been abandoned for a number of years.
In the early days, when you went to Obregon, you had to ford the rivers, and these were not little creeks. These were real rivers where the water came clear up almost over the engine. You had to have a breather tube on an old rubber hose on it in order to be able to get across the river.
Borlaug's breakthrough became known as shuttle breeding.
We found different techniques, what we call shuttle breeding, growing in two different latitudes, different plantings. So we speeded up everything.
Borlaug transferred the best crosses from each locale to the other, resulting in wheat that was broadly adapted to survive at sea level or in the mountains, in drier as well as wetter conditions.
So he completely revolutionized the way wheat was bred by going for a nursery in the off season. No one had ever done that before.
I don't know if anybody thought it was ever going to work or not. But it surely did work, and it made all the difference in the world.
Borlaug had overcome the initial hardships in getting this project off the ground, had bred rust-resistant strains of wheat, and increased the speed of testing new crosses with his innovative shuttle breeding program. But the higher-yielding plants responded so well to irrigation and fertilizer that they grew dangerously tall. And tall wheat has a tendency to lodge or fall over, where it rots before it can be harvested.
The next problem was how to get plants to be fertilized without lodging. Okay. Dr. Vogel, a famous wheat breeder in Washington, received some seeds from an officer who worked with General Douglas MacArthur at the end of World War II. They were from a Japanese variety that was dwarf, a very poor variety in the sense it was highly disease susceptible and poor yielder, but it did have genes to make the plant short.
The challenge was to introduce the gene for shortness from strain B, which Borlaug got from Japan, with the high-yielding but easily lodged strains labeled A. From the first cross of A and B, the plants that look high-yielding but shorter are selected. These selections are then crossed back to the original high-yield strain A. And the selection process is repeated to find plants that are high-yield but shorter. This selection is actually done after these plants are allowed to self-fertilize to make sure that the gene for shortness is carried in the needed form. After repeated crossing and selecting, the gene for shortness in strain B becomes a part of strain A.
In 1962, we suddenly realized that we had something that was big. The dwarf wheat plant was designed for intensive cultivation of wheat under irrigation with heavy fertilization. And when this was all brought together into a package of practices, yield soared. Yields that our farmers here in the Yaqui Valley had never dreamt of were being harvested on vast acreages. We, in the experimental stations, recognized this as something that could be highly useful in hungry areas of the world, far removed from Mexico.
Norman Borlaug never wanted to be an administrator. When reminded to hand in reports, he was heard to say, "What do you want, bread or paper?"
He and George Gerard, the director, fought. They fought intensely because Norm realized that for his program to succeed, he had to do what he wanted to do and thought was important.
I received a confidential official letter from him from New York. He said, we're seriously considering firing Norm. You know, he doesn't turn his expense accounts. He's behind about 3-4 months. And we'd like to have your opinion. I was the director at the time. I said, you know, any idiot stunt like that, it would be the worst thing you could possibly do. He's one of the very best men we have.
Borlaug was on the verge of quitting when Dr. Stakeman, who happened to be visiting, intervened and convinced Borlaug to stay the course. Initially, Borlaug was not aware of an accidental yet brilliant secondary benefit to shuttle breeding. Wheat, like most plants, is sensitive to variations in altitude and the duration of sunlight.
Nobody at that time fully realized that this change in length of day was important for the periodization.
Many plants have a photosensitive protein in their cells that tells them when to flower. For this reason, certain wheat varieties that thrive in one place do poorly in other locations.
By moving these from one environment to the other, suddenly we found that we had some varieties that would fit everywhere in Mexico, completely against the conventional wisdom.
That's why the Mexican wheats are adapted to different sea levels and different altitudes or latitudes.
So after 13 years of struggle, Mexico became self-sufficient in wheat production.
Starting with nothing, Borlaug had overcome almost insurmountable hardships. The new crossbreeds were higher yielding, resistant to pests and diseases, drought resistant, and regionally adapted to various growing conditions. Borlaug had invented shuttle breeding, conquered rust and lodging. A growing prosperity replaced hunger and poverty in Mexico.
Every day, as I drive to our experimental station in Toluca Valley, where we are making really great progress in solving the world's food problems, I drive past this place. This is the chemical factory that produces the raw materials for the pill. You see, there are two sides to this complex human problem. The one of food production and the one of population growth. To give attention to one alone is not enough. Both must be considered and brought into balance one with the other, if there is to be a better life for all of the people of the world.
As the world's population exploded, doomsayers, led by best-selling author Paul Ehrlich, predicted famine would kill millions. Ehrlich wrote, "The battle to feed all of humanity is over. In the 1970s and 1980s, hundreds of millions of people will starve to death in spite of any crash programs embarked upon now. At this late date, nothing can prevent a substantial increase in the world death rate."
At that period, people were actually writing off India. They talked about triage, where you wrote off countries in, like you would write off sick or wounded people in battle, and India would be included in that.
Borlaug shifted his focus to the hungriest countries on the planet, especially India and Pakistan, where 3 million died from hunger in the 1960s. He joined a team assembled by the United Nations to study agricultural issues, but became frustrated by the resistance to change, even after he demonstrated how his techniques had increased Mexico's production by over 600%.
Now, his trip in 1960 to Asia, the first trip he'd made in that part of the world, he saw the need and he saw the possibility that these short-stored Mexican wheats would fit perfectly.
Remember to select for things that you need in your own country back home to fit your own situation. Those of you from India and Pakistan where part of your wheat is grown under irrigation, be sure you're selecting the short dwarf plants.
Agricultural trainees from all over the world flocked to the Mexican experimental stations to learn the new technology and returned home with sample seeds to test in their own fields.
This is a plant that's too tall for irrigated conditions of India and Pakistan, but under the dry or semi-dry conditions of Afghanistan is probably what you want.
India requested 10 million tons of wheat from the United States to avoid food shortages, but President Lyndon Johnson resented Mrs. Gandhi's opposition to the Vietnam War and was stingy with aid.
Lyndon Johnson would release small amounts so that they didn't reach starvation level. But the uncertainties were there. Politics get into all of these things on food production. They're nasty.
To convince aid-dependent countries to become self-sufficient in producing their own food, Borlaug became an unofficial diplomat.
Borlaug works at two levels. That is his great strength. Unlike many other scientists who think that their job is done when they have developed the technology, Borlaug saw to it that the necessary public policy support needed to take the technology to the field was also in place.
Mrs. Gandhi was one of the first leaders to welcome Borlaug's assistance.
Then I used to take him to meet the then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. We also used to go to the various government officials, the chairman of the Planning Commission, the Minister for Agriculture, and so on. He developed a very good rapport with them because he's a person who could see people see the obvious sincerity of what he was saying. There was no hidden agenda except the benefit of the people, and that transparent sincerity of his message came through.
And then you've got to demonstrate it in many hundreds or thousands of places on farmers' fields, but always in the absence of the press, with the Minister of Agriculture, Prime Minister or President, who are the ones that make the decisions.
By 1965, Borlaug and his colleagues had finally won the confidence of political leaders and shipped 250 tons of seed to Pakistan and India.
The fleets of trucks that were carrying the seed from this area of Mexico to Los Angeles were held up and nearly missed the departure for the freighter from Los Angeles because of the Watts racial riots. 3 days after the freighter had left Los Angeles, war was on between Pakistan and India, and both shipments of seed were on the same freighter. To make things even worse, the letter of credit was tangled up and was in disorder, and I told him to ship it and we'd fix this later. And the war was on. So I had a signature on a piece of paper that didn't look very good to many of my administrative superiors.
Half the harvested wheat was used for food. The other half was distributed as seed to farmers. The Green Revolution on the Indian subcontinent was finally underway.
His approach adopted in both countries, and they become self-sufficient and exporters in just a few years. Hundreds of millions of people are saved.
While Borlaug did not mind the diplomatic role, he despised time-consuming office duties.
And then when I come back, we got the annual report. And when I'm going to Argentina, if you let this pile up any deeper, God help us both.
Well, of course, I could set a match to it right now.
Won't you? Just look at this. Just look at it. Paper, bureaucracies. Filling up the world. And it isn't only in the developed countries, but unfortunately in the hungry countries, the same pattern is followed. I suppose they learned from us.
Borlaug persevered both politically and scientifically. Soon, India's test fields of dwarf varieties showed promise that its wheat crop could be quadrupled. Pakistan accomplished in 3 years what had taken Mexico 15 years.
There was this huge harvest, mountains of grain by the railroad sidings waiting to be shipped, unthrashed grain on the threshing floors, and finally it was so bad they had to close the schools and store the grain.
Both India and Pakistan had increased their yields 7 to 10-fold.
And this creates tremendous enthusiasm from the farmer who has always, the peasant farmer who's always been accused of being conservative. He's not conservative. You show him a chance of making an improvement in his way of life, and if the difference between his former method and the results that he gets with the new is great enough, he'll go ahead with it.
The Green Revolution marched forward, and soon Turkey, Afghanistan, Tunisia, and Morocco planting sample wheat seeds in the effort to solve their own hunger crises. In 1974, only 2 years after President Nixon's historic meetings in China, Norman Borlaug was sent on an agricultural exchange mission.
And I still remember, at the same age, people die on starvation. 1960, 61, 62, 1966, 67. At that time, I still remember when I was in elementary school, I was hoping that one day, if I can eat just a tiny, tiny rice, I would be damn happy, because not enough rice. Eating a sweet potato every day, not enough.
Borlaug's technology had preceded him. China had already received test packets of Mexican seed through Pakistan and later purchased 5,000 tons of the high-yielding wheat. This success also instigated similar boosts in other crops. IR-8, the new miracle rice, was produced at the International Rice Research Institute in the Philippines. Like the hybrid wheats, this rice was short-strawed and able to stand erect when well-fertilized. The new rice more than doubled production, and the Philippines exported not only the grain, but also the technology. The Green Revolution preserved millions of acres of forests and wildlife habitats. In 1960, the world produced 692 million tons of grain. 4 decades later, it was almost 2 billion tons, a threefold increase, utilizing the same amount of land. If we did not have Borlaug's technology, farmers could not produce the amount of food the world requires today without further encroaching on the rainforests and other sensitive ecosystems.
If you had to produce the amount of food that the world requires now at the same yield level, the area you would require would basically wipe out the earth, you know, the rainforests and everything. So the productivity of these short-statured varieties and their responsiveness to inputs has allowed civilization to produce its food, society to produce its food on this basically the same area. And, you know, that is a major achievement.
Hello? Yes. No, he's not here.
According to my mother, the phone started ringing about 4 o'clock in the morning in Mexico City time, and Daddy had already gotten up and gone to the experimental station in Toluca, which is outside of Mexico City.
So, you know, Dr. Borlaug worked in the field with all of us, all the students, and we saw a car coming down through the field on the other side of a large irrigation ditch. And Dr. Borlaug says, That looks like Margaret.
I was out harvesting. I had several of these people from different countries right beside me, and suddenly a car from the office with my wife Margaret arrived, and she said, "Look, about half an hour after you left this morning, I got a call, and then repeatedly three or four others saying, we need to speak to Dr. Borlaug soon."
So she says, "Norman, you won the Nobel Prize." And he said, "Oh, the hell I did."
And I think he refused to believe it. He thought, well, it's just a hoax. I won the Nobel Peace Prize, but he in actuality had.
"I call upon you, Norman Ernest Borlaug, to come to the rostrum and receive the diploma and the gold medal of the Nobel Peace Prize for 1970.
Obviously, I am personally honored beyond all dreams by this election, but the obligations imposed by the honors are far greater than the honor itself.
While the glittering prizes helped promote his cause, Borlaug's urgent desire to fight hunger only increased, leaving little time for his wife and children.
When we first came to Mexico, he was gone a lot. The days were long, but he was home more often. Then when he started going up to Sonora, his trips became longer. But in the last 10 or 15 years, since we've been doing international work, he's been gone 2 to 3 months at a time.
"Well, I guess I better get going.
You gonna be late tonight, as usual?"
"Well, can't tell.
Every morning we go through this same. He's gone, I don't know when he'll be back. He says he doesn't know. It's usually very late, anytime between 8 and 10 o'clock at night. So dinner is usually cold when he gets home, but he takes it that way."
"I'm not interested in money. I will leave this world probably about as poor as I came into it. I have given my son and daughter a good education, and I'm convinced that these are the important things."
Borlaug did try to reserve some time for his family, out of love for his son Bill, as well as sports. Borlaug is credited with introducing Little League Baseball to Mexico.
"It began as a neighborhood activity, parents sponsored. It's entirely amateur, and it has grown now in these 13 years into an activity throughout the Republic in which more than 15,000 boys participate."
He was gone quite a bit, but once I started baseball, somehow he always found his way back on Tuesdays and Thursdays, which were our practice days, and then played on Saturday and Sunday, and he was usually back out traveling on Mondays. But Little League sort of became the epicenter of our life in Mexico, so somehow he scheduled his traveling around Little League.
"I see a great parallel between what boys learn on an athletic field, what I learn on an athletic field, and how I react to certain situations in science when I'm trying to interject an entirely different spirit into a group of scientists, whether it be in India or Pakistan or Turkey or Iran or in Mexico."
Borlaug continued working to develop the most productive wheat varieties to meet the needs of the exponentially increasing global population. He never expected any personal acknowledgement, let alone the Nobel Peace Prize and the numerous high honors that followed.
"I am acutely conscious of the fact that I am but one member of that vast army of hunger fighters. And so I want to share not only the present honors, but also the future obligations with all my companions in arms. For the Green Revolution has not yet been won."
In 1984, Borlaug received a call from Japanese philanthropist Ryoichi Sasakawa. He asked Borlaug to help him bring the Green Revolution to Africa. Borlaug, who at 70 wanted to be semi-retired, said he was too old to undertake a new continent. The next morning, Sasakawa called again and said, "I'm 15 years older than you. We should have started this project yesterday, but let's start tomorrow." Borlaug was shocked by the devastating malnutrition he witnessed when he was escorted to a village in Ghana.
Namibachire, when we went there, was just like any other Ghanaian village. Mothers who didn't look too healthy, and looking at children, you could just see the clinical signs of malnutrition. Puffy face, red hair, swollen limbs.
It's a year old. And you see how all the hair has gone. Okay, the edema has gone down. Because the last time when we were here, you know, the feet were all so swollen. But now this child is cold. The child is cold. The child is cold.
This child just died in our hands.
The child was gone. It's hard for a person from Western countries to understand this. They have to see it. How would you feel if it were your child? I know how I would feel if it were my child.
Sasakawa, Borlaug, and President Jimmy Carter founded an initiative to promote African agriculture. Not only did Borlaug want to produce the highest yielding crops, it was essential for them to be as nutritious as possible.
From then on, whenever possible, Dr. Borlaug and I would go to Africa together. I would do primarily the political arrangements. I would meet with the heads of state, and I would work out with their ministers of finance and agriculture and so forth on a program, and then we would start with just a few farmers and introduce what was then Global 2000, later became Sasakawa Global 2000, to increase their production of food grains.
At CIMMYT, which had been Borlaug's headquarters in Mexico for many years, scientists developed a high-protein corn hybrid called Quality Protein Maize, which had the potential to prevent malnutrition disorders. But the countries that needed it most were reluctant to try something new.
They had developed a corn or maize that had all the amino acids. It was really a complete food, but they hadn't been able to get any country in the world to try it. And so one night we were going to have a formal dinner with President Jerry Rawlings, and Norman and I met in my hotel room, and Norman said, "This is something that I have wanted to see all my life, my recent life, is for some country to adopt this." And I said, "Well, I'll bring it up with Jerry Rawlings." So in the middle of a supper, we were talking about a lot of the things. I said, "Jerry, Mr. President, I wonder if you'd be willing to commit the government of Ghana to the production of a new kind of maize that has all the amino acids. It's a complete food." And Norm was sitting there with bated breath to see the answer. And Jerry Rawlings said, "Mr. President, I would be delighted to do that, and I'll turn over the whole resources of my government to it." Dr. Borlaug broke out in tears of emotion and gratitude.
Every spring, when the wheat is ready for harvest, Norman Borlaug still returns to his beloved fields at Obregon. At the age of 95, he goes into the fields to inspect the latest crosses and offer his advice to the current crop of students and wheat breeders. The young farmers and the old friends welcome him like the returning hero he is. His sturdy, high-yielding wheats have made this once destitute valley prosperous.
This is leafless, man. Stemless would have had more effect.
While Borlaug's enormous achievements in saving untold millions of lives from starvation have put him at the level of those people who have changed the course of history, he feels he will not have any lasting legacy unless his successors develop more tools and new technologies to feed the constantly escalating population on a planet with dwindling resources. Today, one of the major threats to the worldwide food supply is a new race of wheat rust, which started in East Africa and travels in the jet streams, recognizing no political boundaries. Dr. Ronnie Kaufman, who was a student in the field the day Borlaug heard he won the Nobel Peace Prize, is now leading the Borlaug Global Rust Initiative.
To protect world wheat supplies in vulnerable regions of the developing world, in Africa and Asia.
You have a resistant wheat, then a new race comes along, and now there's a threat from other parts of the world, a serious threat. Norm was so concerned he made this Paul Revere trip a number of years ago, stirring everybody up, alerting them to this new threat. And this will provide a basis for protecting North America and other parts of the world.
Borlaug, who spearheaded the development of the first rust-resistant wheats, helped pull together this latest worldwide program, funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. He insisted on being present for the announcement of the project in his beloved Yaqui Valley fields.
Well, if you go back to Norm Borlaug's speech when he got the Nobel Peace Prize, he said there were two elements, the population monster and food. The population monster has largely been ignored on a worldwide basis, and that's continues to be a very serious and dangerous situation.
When you look at the places in the world now in violence, because the society, the economy was so broken down by famine, by extreme poverty, if we let these problems fester because we think that's not our problem, we end up with a wholly unstable world. We can't afford to let these problems continue to expand the way we've been doing so. We have to address them. We're going to find it's the biggest bargain on the planet.
And nowadays with globalization, these formerly completely isolated villagers who didn't know anything further than 5 miles away, they now have an ability to see what goes on in the rest of the world. And they see the rich world living like kings when they're still starving to death. It breeds within them an animosity against people who are better off than they are, who refuse to help.
It's absolutely possible to end hunger on this planet. I don't know why we haven't done it long ago, because it would only take a modest investment to reach all the people on this planet with adequate amounts of food.
Every prize gave Norman Borlaug another platform to deliver his message. At age 92, he won the Congressional Gold Medal.
For hunger and poverty and misery are very fertile soils into which to plant all kinds of isms, including terrorism. I thank you very much for the support that you have all given, and especially in that critical period of the 60s when the world said nothing can be done. Look what happened. Thank you.
All of these people who are part of our staff here at the present time are the people who have made most of the contributions.
Well, I say that if I have done something, it's been a leader of a team, and I couldn't have done anything alone. Those who were my students who passed this on, this is an ongoing thing. When I was born, was about 1.6 billion people. Today it's about 6.6 billion, but it's still increasing at about 83 or 84 million more each year. This has to be changed. If the people of the affluent nations want to hope to have tranquility and peace for their children and grandchildren, it won't be based on human misery and poverty, starting with hunger. lack of education, lack of medical service. And my belief is that in the game of baseball, you've got to go in with the spirit of will to win, not with defeatism. And so it is with the biggest and most important game of all, the game of life.